Hi everyone. In this section, I would like to have a brief description about the nuclear reactors. Before going to the nuclear reactors, you have to know the basics about nuclear reactions. And for that, I have already sent you two PDFs through Moodle platform. I hope all of you have went through it at least once. If not, please go and check it. And in case of any doubt in that PDF, you can contact me. And I'll give you a brief description about the nuclear reaction now. Like nuclear reactions are basically of two types, nuclear fission reaction and nuclear fusion reaction. The later one, that is the nuclear fusion reaction, is joining of two nucleuses together to form a single nucleus, and that is happening in sun. And whereas the first one, that is nuclear fission reaction, is a splitting of a single nucleus into two or more nucleus by bombarding of that single nucleus by another neutron. So which can be done in a controllable manner with the help of some reactors, which is called a nuclear reactors. And in this session, we are going to see more about that nuclear reactors. So nuclear fission reaction is the process when a neutron collides with a nucleus of heavy atoms, causing the original atom to split into two or more unequal fragments, which carry most of the energy of fission as kinetic energy. This process is accompanied by the emission of neutrons and gamma rays. I'll make it more clear with the help of some figures, like when a neutron is come and bombarded with a heavy atom neutron, in case this is a uranium-235, when it collides with the neutron, it will become uranium-236, which is highly unstable, and hence it wants to become a stable product. Hence, it will split into two products like krypton 92 atom and barium 141 atom. So, a new uranium 235, when it comes and bombarded with another neutron, it will become uranium 236, which is highly unstable. So, it always wants to become stable. Hence, it will split into two products like barium and krypton. So, barium is having 141 neutrons and the krypton having 92. So here 92 plus 141, it is 233. So uranium is having 235 neutrons. In these two together only having 233. That is two neutron is missing. And plus one neutron when it's bombarded is also missing. So that it will emit as an neutrons as it. That is three neutrons plus three neutrons will be there after the fission reaction. Extra, we will have heat energy, that is 202.5 mega electric volt, and also the emission of gamma rays also there. So when a uranium 235 is a heavy metal is bombarded with a neutron, it will become unstable and will split into three, that is barium 141 and krypton 92 plus three neutrons and some heat energy and also some radiation with gamma radiation. And this neutron, which possess high kinetic energy, will again further move together and will again bombarded with another uranium 235 to produce another three electrons and one for this barium and krypton. So these three will again collide with another three, means like an exponential chain reaction. This reaction will proceed further, more and more amount of heat energy will release and more amount of radiation also will begin. So our intention is to perform this reaction in a controllable manner and to make use of the heat energy which is generated through this fission reaction. For that, we have nuclear reactors. Nuclear reactors is an apparatus in which nuclear fission is produced in the form of controlled self-sustaining chain reaction, or we can say it is an apparatus in which heat is produced due to nuclear fission chain reaction for the generation of electricity. We can see what are the essential components of a nuclear reactor. A nuclear reactor contains basic and most importantly should contain a reactor core within which the reaction takes place, a reflector, control mechanisms, moderator, coolant, measuring instrument, and shield. We can see one by one incoming slides. First one is the reactor core. We already mentioned that it is an important point or important part within the nuclear fission reaction is taking place and the energy is released in the form of heat in the re- reactor core. And the reactor core consists of fuel elements, usually a heavy metal, which is radioactive, and control rod, coolant, moderator. We can, and the fuel element, usually we can use plutonium, uranium, whatever it is, radioactive material. And that should be in form of either plates or rods. And that plates or rods are again shielded with a stainless steel, zirconium or aluminium in order to protect it from corrosion or as a part of corrosion resistance, and also to retain its radioactivity characteristics and also provide some structural support in some cases. And that thing is there as main part of, should be there in the core, that is a fuel element. And there should be enough space which is provided between these fuel elements so as the coolant can easily pass to this fuel element. So this is a reactor core. We can see that this black is noted as the fuel rod or plate, and enough space is provided between the fuel elements so that the coolant can be passed from the bottom. And when the coolant is there, then the nuclear fission reaction is taking place, it will become heat and become lighter and can be taken from the outside. The function of the coolant is to cool or to absorb the heat energy inside the reactor core, and also we can take the heat energy to heat exchanger with the help of a coolant and to make use of that heat energy to produce electricity. The two functions, one to make the reactor core cool, and also to take up the heat for being utilized. Next is moderator, which is there in the reactor core. The function of a moderator to slow down the neutrons which is emitting from the nuclear fission reaction, that is to absorb the kinetic energy of the neutrons which is emitting from the nuclear fission reaction. And next is the reflector. The function of the reflector is, in case any of the neutrons is escaped out from the nuclear core, reactor core, the reflector will reflect back that neutrons back into the core so that it won't escape out. Next is the shielding. Shielding is to protect us from the heavy, we know that gamma rays are also released as a part of the nuclear fission reaction, to protect us from the heavy and harmful gamma ray radiation, also to protect the new parts of the reactor. And there are control rods. The control rods control the entire process in the reactor, to start the reaction process and to maintain the reaction process in a normal working condition level, and to stop the working of the reactor in case of emergency and also in case of normal condition. So this is about a reactor, nuclear reactor, and this is how it actually looks like. So we can see one by one in more much detail. Like, reflector is usually placed around the core to reflect back some of the neutrons that leak out from the surface of the core. The material of the reflector is same as that of the moderator. Next is control mechanisms. For starting the reactor, that is to bring the reactor up to its normal operating level and to maintaining that level, and for shutting the reactor down under normal and also under emergency conditions. Next is moderator. Moderator is to slow down the neutrons from high velocity and hence from the high energy level. The moderator, what they do is that they absorb the part of the kinetic energy of the neutrons by collide directly with the neutrons. When the neutron collide with the moderator, that moderator will absorb the kinetic energy of the moderator, and hence they will reduce the velocity, and we can bring from the high energy level to low energy level. And to control the entire reaction under control, on a control level. So next is, there has been no ideal moderating material available in the nature as it, or has been produced artificially. So far, most convenient moderator material identified is heavy water, that is D2O. And the properties that should be a moderator process are, it should have high slowdown power and should have low parasite capture. So the moderator is intended to capture the nucleus and neutrons and thereby slowing down the neutrons. So it should not desirable to capture any other thing. So it should low parasite capture, non-corrosiveness, It should be machinability if it is solid, and high melting point if it is solid, low melting point if it is liquid. It is written as solid, but it's liquid. Then it should have a chemical stability, radiation stability, high thermal conductivity, and most importantly, it should be available in abundant in pure form, so that we don't face any unavailability of the material. Next is coolant. The coolant is to remove the heat which is produced inside the core and the reactor, and to bring out the heat energy for being utilized. And the properties that a coolant should be possess are low parasite capture, low melting point and high boiling point, low viscosity, non-toxic and non-corrosiveness, high density that will reduce the pumping power. With the low means if with a single pumping of the coolant, whether it is a water or whatever it is, it will get high mass if it is having high density. So with the, we can reduce the energy which is required for pumping. Then specific heat, and it should be chemically stable and radiation stability. Next, the most measuring instrument. The measuring instrument which should be available in case of a nuclear reactor is the measuring the thermal neutron flux that will indicate how much power which is produced inside a reactor. Next is the shielding. Shielding is very important. We already mentioned that gamma rays will produce as a result of the fission reaction, which is highly dangerous. And we have to protect ourselves, and also we have to protect the walls of the nuclear reactor from the radiation damaged. So protect the walls of the reactor from vessels of the from the radiation damage. Protect the operating personnel from the exposure to radiate. The effectiveness of this particular shield is depend upon how much mass it possesses. In case we can say we can use heavy metals like lead for effective shielding per unit weight, but in case of fast penetrating neutron, fast neutron, the heavy metals won't work that much effectively. In that cases, light metal will work effectively. Like one condition that for fast neutron shielding, it is recommendable for using light material. But the more effective shielding will be provided if we use this heavy material. So there is an extreme condition between this light and heavy materials. Like, so in case of this, and to overcome this conditions, we can make use of concrete, which possesses both these characteristics of fast neutron shielding and effective shield per unit weight. We can make use of this concrete, and which is low cost and easily available. And while designing a shielding material or shield, first you have to take in how much amount of the radiation is produced in particular type that particular reactor, and how much amount of radiation is allowed to pass through or is okay to pass through the shield material, and the nature of the or property of the material that we selected for making the shield. So these three points you have to kept in mind for designing a shielding material. So these are the parts of a reactor core. Now we can see nuclear reactors. In this section, I only discussed two types of reactor. First one is a pressurized water reactor. So as the name indicates, we are using pressurized water, especially light water, pressurized light water as both coolant and moderator. So we can see the working of a nuclear pressurized water reactor. So it constitute two circuits, one a primary circuit and a secondary circuit. The primary circuit includes a reactor, a pressurizer and a circulating pump, which is the entire circuit is connected to a heat exchanger. And the secondary circuit, we'll come to the secondary circuit later. The reaction occurs in the reactor, and as the reaction occurs, the heat energy is released, and that heat energy is absorbed by the coolant. In this case, we are using light water that is pressurized. So there is a pressurizer used here to maintain the pressure of the water up to 100 kgf per centimeter square, so that the boiling point is raised so that the water is not boiled. So we know that very high temperature is there in the reactor. So we are maintaining the pressure, very high pressure, so that the water is not boiling. So the heat water from the reactor will go to the heat exchanger, where it will exchange its heat to water in a secondary circuit that is not maintained at high pressure or there. So it will automatically boil and it will become steam. that steam will give to the turbo generator to generate electricity, and after that it will go to the condenser to cool to water. That water is again using a feed pump back to the heat exchanger. So there is a heat exchanger in common. And in one more point that should be kept in mind of this pressurized water reactor is that the water which is there in the primary circuit possesses radioactivity, whereas in the water in the secondary circuit is free from radioactivity. So the water in the primary circuit should be protected or shielded so that it won't harmful to when it comes in the part of the heat exchanger. That's about the pressurized water reactor. And next is the boiling water reactor. Working is same as that of the previous one. Only thing that we are not using any pressurizer here. When the water is passed to the reactor, it will boil due to the high temperature in or high heat inside the reactor. As it boils, it will become steam, and that steam is given to a turbo generator, thereby generating electricity and supply to the point of use. And after that, the steam is then passed to the condenser to become water, and then from the condenser, the water is again pumped back to as the coolant to the reactor. So this is how a boiling water reactor working, and we already discussed how a pressurized water reactor is working. So this is the two basic working means basic reactors and it's working. Hope this part is clear to you guys. And in case of doubt, you can contact me. Thank you.